All right, let's all stand.
Worship our King. Come, let us bow at His feet. He has done great things. See what our Savior has done. See how His love overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great things.
The new has come.
now. Resurrection power living on the inside, Jesus. You have given us freedom. No longer bound by sin and darkness, living in the light of your goodness. You have given us freedom.
I'm dressed in your royalty. Your Holy Spirit lives in me. And I see my past has been redeemed. The new has come.
Now I have resurrection power living on the inside, Jesus. You have given us freedom. No longer bound by sin and darkness, living in the light of your goodness. You have given us freedom.
Freedom, you have given us freedom. You have given us freedom. My chains are gone.
Freedom, you have given us freedom. You have given us freedom.
Oh, hallelujah.
Sing that freedom.
Freedom, you have given us freedom. You have given us freedom. My chains are gone. Freedom, you have given us freedom. You have given us freedom. Resurrection power living on the inside, Jesus. You have given us freedom. No longer bound by sin and darkness, living in the light of your goodness. You have given us freedom. Now I have resurrection power.
Good morning and welcome, and what a day to celebrate the freedom that we've been given in Jesus Christ our Lord. Today is my favorite day of the year, and we get together every week. In case you're visiting, we do this every week, but we get together every week and we worship our Savior Jesus Christ. But today is the day that we get to focus in on that incredible day, that resurrection day, and it changed everything. You know, 2,000 years ago when Jesus hung on the cross and he died and he was buried, and Pastor Zach's going to talk about this in a few minutes, but there were people, they didn't know what to do. They didn't know where to go. They didn't know what was happening. But then Jesus changed everything when he rose from the grave. You know, one of my favoriteest things that Jesus said about himself is he said, "I am the light of the world." And I don't know what you're going through right now, and I don't know what situation you're coming out of, and I'm sure in a room this size with this many people, there's a lot of us going through something. But Jesus knows, and he wants to come into your life, and he wants to shine his light so that you can see that you also can share in that resurrection power. You also can have that hope that comes with knowing that our Savior did not stay dead, but he rose from the grave, conquering sin, death, hell itself, and anything else that ever wants to get in his way. Jesus has conquered it all, and it's an incredible thing. If you're visiting with us this morning, If you're visiting, we want to welcome you. We thank you so much for choosing us today. We feel honored that you would do that. When you came in, you got two pieces of paper. One's a bulletin. It's got a lot of information in it. But inside that bulletin, there's a tear-out sheet, and it's got the words connect card at the top. We would invite you, just fill out that connect card. Later on in the service, we're going to take up some tithes and offerings in our giving time. And that's for us. That's for the people that, this is our home church, and we're members here. That's for us. That's not for you, our visitors. For you, just put that card in the plate and let us know that you were here. That would just be gift enough from you, and we would thank you for doing that. And then as you leave today, Pastor Zach and his wife Julie, they're going to be out. There's a blue tent right outside. They're going to be hanging out there, and they would love to shake your hand, hear your story, and get to know you. Maybe you're visiting for the weekend. Maybe you live around here, and you just decided, hey, you know what? I'm going to check church out today. They want to meet you. They want to get to know you, and they also have a gift for you. No hassle, no commitment. They just want to give you something just to bless you and your family. And so if you'd be so kind as to fill that card out later on, stop by the tent and see them. That would be awesome. Thank you for being here. We're going to continue to worship. But before we do, let's take a few moments. Let's greet each other around us. So turn around, shake a hand, and then we'll get back to worship.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living Lord. Who could imagine has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my oh, hallelujah, praise the one. morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning
that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me.
Oh, Jesus, yours is the
praise you today. God, you reign. Lord, one day every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Father, we praise you that you have won the victory over hell and the grave and death and sin. Lord, we praise you today. God, and we ask that in this place that you would move and do what only you can do. God, to bring restoration and healing. Pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You can have a seat.
Good morning to you. Now, I've had two services already, and there was a lot of sin in those services, so my voice isn't quite as strong, all right? So y'all bear with me a little bit. It's 1 Peter. If you have your copy of God's Word, go ahead and open it up there. 1 Peter, the second chapter, is where we're going to read from this morning. When 1 Peter was written, the church, Christianity, was experiencing extreme hostility from the world around it. And it was a very difficult time to follow Christ. Stephen had already been martyred. James had been killed. Soon, Peter, who was writing from Rome, would be crucified upside down. So this was a difficult time to be a believer in Jesus Christ. The people that he was writing to were suffering greatly. Some had lost their jobs. Some had come to Christ and lost their marriage in the process because their husband or their wife did not want to come into the faith. Others had been imprisoned. But everybody, to one degree or another, was suffering greatly. From the time this letter was written, over the next 250 years, things would change. As a matter of fact, about 250 years later, Caesar himself would profess faith in Jesus Christ. And Christianity not only would become legalized, but it would become the national religion of the Roman Empire. To what do we attribute this rapid, explosive growth? Historians have asked that question for many, many years. And the number one thing that they keep coming back to and say that's what made Christianity different from all the other religions was not just its theological claims, but practically how the believers in Christ responded to suffering. And the principle of how to face suffering as a believer in Jesus is found in our text today. This is what caused the church to grow so rapidly. It wasn't great sermons, it wasn't great programs, but it was just how they faced difficult times. We're going to read through the passage this morning, and I'm going to show you three things about how they faced suffering in light of Easter. Look at what it says in verse 21. For to this, that is suffering, you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you. Now notice this, leaving you an example. So something about the way Jesus suffered to pay for our sins on the cross, to be buried and to be raised again, something about that was a pattern or an example for you to follow. And it says, so that you may follow in his footsteps. Over the next few minutes, I'm going to zoom us in on those last 3 days, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. We're going to look at each one of those days, Friday, Good Friday, the day of pain. And we're going to talk about how Jesus faced the day of pain. Some of you today are in a painful season of your life. And secondly, we're going to look at Saturday. We're going to talk about the day of just perplexing circumstances. Some days, you wake up and you just say, what just happened? Is this real or is this a dream? How did Jesus faced those days and the disciples faced those days. And then thirdly, Easter, the day of promise. How do you get through to the day of promise? And as we do that, we're going to answer three fundamental questions. How do we get through the days of pain? What do we do in the days of perplexity? And how do we ultimately press into the days of promise? Let's look at each one of those. Number one, the days of pain. A pastor pulled me to the side soon after I surrendered to the ministry, an older pastor. I'll never forget what he said. He said, Zach, he said, always preach to hurting people and you will never lack a congregation. He says, there's pain in every pew. There is sorrow in every seat. You're either in a storm, you're going into a storm, or you're coming out of a storm. But this side of Eden, storms are a part of life. And suffering's a part of life. It's not supposed to be this way. That's why we have such a hard time with it. We were created for Eden. But Satan came into the world. He tempted Eve. Eve tempted Adam. And Adam ate us out of house and home. And so here we are, outside. We're east of Eden in pain. Every pain in your life goes directly back to Eden. And so we face that. We deal with that on a weekly, a daily, sometimes an hourly basis. Pain is a very real part of life. Some of you today are facing physical pain. Some of you are literally physically hurting today. Some of you have chronic illnesses that just won't go away. Some of you, you're experiencing the pain that comes with aging. I woke up the other day and I felt like I'd sprained my ankle. And I looked at Julie and said, I don't remember tripping. Did I trip and forget about it? And I feel like I have a sprained ankle. And then when the clouds blew over, it went away. It was my first visit from Mr. Arthur, arthritis, you know. And it's a part of growing older. Things happen. A guy came to me the other day and he said, Zach, he said, everything hurts. And what doesn't hurt doesn't work. That's just how it is sometimes, this side of paradise, this side of Eden. Physical pain. Not only is there physical pain, sometimes it's easier to deal with physical pain than it is emotional pain. Some of us deal with emotional pain, dreams that just didn't come to fruition. Maybe the job, the dream job that you felt like even God had called you to, and you stepped out by faith, and you went into that field, and then you lost your career, or it just didn't pan out, or the doors just didn't open. Maybe it was a marriage that you just thought was the right thing, and it just didn't work out. Nothing hurts like that ending of a relationship. Maybe it's a parent that you thought was supposed to always be there for you, and they weren't. Maybe it's a child that just didn't go the direction you thought that she would go or he would go. But emotional pain can take such a toll, and a lot of times it produces physical pain. But then there's spiritual pain. Those times when you feel like God is distant or maybe not even there at all. Those times when you question everything you've always believed. Those nights when you lie awake, you try to pray, but it feels like your prayers don't get any higher than the ceiling. Spiritual pain. Well, as Jesus faced Friday, Good Friday, he faced all three of those. He faced physical pain. There's no depiction, whether it be in art, cinema, whatever it might be, that does justice to the physical pain that Jesus endured on the cross. As Jesus went from the trial, the whipping with a cat of nine tails, to being nailed to a cross of wood, there's nothing you've seen that does justice to the pain. We, in our family, for a long time now, every Good Friday, the Saturday before Easter, then Easter Sunday, we watch the Passion of the Christ. And normally we watch it, we have to pause and unpack what's going on, and we've done that for years. And that's the best I've seen at showing what it actually probably looked like to see Jesus. However, it falls short. You see, according to the prophet Isaiah, he was marred beyond the semblance of a man, that he didn't even look human. He had been beaten so much. When they whipped him with a cat of nine tails, he was tied to a whipping post, and the leather strands, nine leather strands about that long, that had, tell them I'll call them back in a minute, okay? They had bone fragments, shard pieces of glass. They had all the stuff tied into those leather strands. And then 39 times, Jesus would have been whipped, and it would grasp over his flesh, sinking into his flesh, and then it would be torn out, throwing fragments of bone at times. At times, it would pull the rib loose from the body. It was a hellish treatment physically. By the time Jesus got to the cross, people weren't saying, "Who is that?" They were saying, "What is that?" There is no way to describe the swelling, the intense agony and pain that Jesus suffered on the cross. If you have hurt physically, Jesus can relate. I may not be able to relate, but he gets it. He's felt pain. Not only physical pain, Jesus felt emotional pain. As he faced the cross, all of his inner circle abandoned him. They all walked out on him. One even sold him for 50 pieces of silver, betraying him into the hands of his enemies. They all walked out on Jesus. If you're facing emotional pain, Jesus knows what it's like. Jesus was stripped naked before being placed upon the cross and lifted above the crowds, too much for even modern art to express fully. He knows physical pain. He knows emotional pain. Thirdly, he knows spiritual pain. As Jesus prayed in the garden, and looked into heaven, gazing into the abyss before him, he saw charging at him hell itself. Utter separation from the Father, but beyond that, the loving, perfect Father he had had from eternity past, now treating him as an enemy, pouring out his wrath, waging war on the Son who was bearing our sin. And that's why he prayed, if possible, let this cup pass from me. It was a cup of the wrath of God. And there on the cross, he faced spiritual pain. Jesus, I don't care what you've been through. I do care, but it doesn't matter in the sense that Jesus can relate. He can understand. Have you ever felt rejected? Have you ever felt alone? Have you ever felt like you lost everything that matters on this planet? Then Jesus, you don't have a high priest who cannot sympathize. You have a Jesus who looks at you and says, I know what you feel like. I felt what you feel and even more. You say, well, Pastor, what do I do when I face those times, those seasons of pain, those days of pain? A few things I want to give you just to help. Number one, or letter A, reach out to friends. Jesus called his close friends around him during the days of intense suffering and intense pain. If the Son of God needed friends around him to face the cross, you need friends around you to face your days of pain as well. That's why just about every Sunday in this church, in one way or the other, we will sell you on the ideas of small groups. You getting around in a group with a few other people, 8 or 10 people who are at the same age as you, going through the same things of life that you're going through, that you can go through it together. You're going to need it. Don't say I didn't warn you. Now, it expresses itself in a lot of different ways. We have some people who kind of do the traditional Sunday school model where they get here an hour early or they stay an hour late. They meet in one of the many classrooms we have on our campus, and they open up a Bible or a quarterly, and they study a lesson, and they build relationships. They build fellowship. They get to know each other. Others meet in restaurants during the week. Some meet in homes. But some have very informal ways of gathering. They just come together and get at a fast food place, and they just kind of meet and talk about life and talk about what the Scripture teaches and pray for one another. But here's what it all comes down to. I know that chances are you're going to go through a day where it's going to be 2 o'clock in the morning and the bottom's going to fall out. And you're going to have something happen that you didn't expect to happen. And as insured as you may be, you're not going to be ready for this. And what my desire as your pastor is, I desire that you have 2 or 3 numbers on speed dial in your phone. That at 2 o'clock in the morning, when the bottom falls out, that if you don't call your friends from First Baptist Church, they're going to be upset with you, they're going to be angry with you, and you're going to hear about it the next day. And you're going to feel like no matter what goes on, you got 2 or 3 people that you can call on. Listen, friend, if Jesus needed a tribe, you need a tribe. If Jesus needed friends, you need friends. And however it looks for you, you need to be a part of a Bible-believing church. You need to be a part within that church of what I call a church within a church, a small group, so that you've got those people around you when the going gets rough. Secondly, learn how to be real and authentic in the midst of your struggle. That comes very easy for some. It comes very difficult for others. It's hard for me. I've got just a handful of people that I'm very transparent with, that I'll tell what I'm really feeling. You know how we are in the South. We have this thing that we do. We walk by people at Walmart and say, hey, how you doing? And we say, I'm fine. And you know you're lying. You know what I'm talking about? We go through that. That's just who we are in the South. It's not that big a deal, but it's what we do. What you need is you need a few people in your life that you can look at and go, how you doing? And they say, fine. And you say, no, really, how are you doing? You see, if you pass somebody at Walmart and they say, how you doing? They really don't want to know, okay? I mean, they're just being nice. This is the South. That's what we do. But you need a few people who really do want to know. And you need a few people who can see through the veneer and go, no, really, I can tell you're not fine. What's going on? Let's have lunch. Let's have some coffee. Let's talk. You need that in your life. And when it happens, you need to be able to be real. Jesus said in verse 38 of Matthew 26, my soul is very sorrowful even to death. Jesus looked at his friends and he said, boys, I feel like dying right now. This is killing me. This is killing me. I'm hurting like I've never hurt before. If you want to make it through the days of pain, you need to be able to look at people that love you, that you love, and say, what I'm going through in life is ripping my soul out. It's killing me. And if you don't have that, it's going to be very difficult for you to make it through those days. You need to be that for somebody else, and you need to have that for yourself. You need to learn to be open and authentic. Thirdly, you need to know how to draw near to God. You need to be able to remember even the best of human friends. You know, when your day of pain is over, their life goes on. It hadn't moved on for you yet. So you better know how to draw near to a friend that sticketh closer to a brother than a brother. Jesus, in our text, he cries out and he says, Abba, Father. Abba was like dada in the English language. In Aramaic, Abba was the first word that a child would learn when he was learning how to talk. Dada, Abba. He cried out, Abba, Father, help me. And he prayed the Gethsemane prayer, and it had three parts. He said, God, all things are possible with you. You have all power. Then he said, let this cup pass from me. Then he said, not my will, but yours be done. You need to have the ability, if you're going to go through the day of pain, that even though your friends, like the friends of Jesus, may fall asleep on you, you need to be able to draw near to your Heavenly Father. And the Gethsemane prayer, if you don't have time to write this down right now because I'm going to move on, go back and listen to it online and make sure you get this. It's very important. I pray this all throughout my life, many times over the years, probably thousands of times before I die. Lord, you're all powerful. I'm going to confess your sovereignty. Secondly, here's what I want. You know, the Bible tells us to cast all of our cares upon him. We don't know what he wants. He wants to know what we want, what you want. What are you asking for? Tell me what it is you want me to do. Vague prayers get vague answers. Specific prayers get specific answers. And then thirdly, not my will, but your will be done. If what I want is not what you want more than what I want. You have all power. Here's what I want. I'm submitting to your perfect will. You need to learn to let that be the knee-jerk reaction every time you're going through the day of pain. Lord, you're powerful. This is happening because you're letting it happen. You could stop it just like that. You could change the channel just like that. I want this to change, but not what I want, what you want. When you face the day of pain, draw near to your friends, be open and authentic, and then draw near to God. Secondly, the second day Jesus faced was Saturday, the disciples faced. This is the day of perplexity. Sometimes the adrenaline rush in the midst of the day of pain will get us through. But then when the funeral's over, when the doctor's report has come, the people have left and gone home, that's when the day of perplexity and confusion and doubt sets in. Can you imagine what the disciples were going through on Saturday? The God of the universe in their mind was buried in a borrowed tomb, completely dead, no air in his lungs, his pupils weren't dilating, his cells weren't reproducing, his blood wasn't flowing. He was dead. Have you ever woke up and just went, what just happened? Have you ever woke up one morning and just thought, is this real or a dream? Did what I think happened yesterday really happen yesterday? Well, that's what they were feeling. On days of perplexity, there's a few things that you go through. One is second guessing. Don't you imagine that the disciples thought. You know, Jesus said, the one who will betray me will dip his bread in the cup at the same time I do. Well, they saw it was Judas. He looked at Judas and he said, go do what you do. Go do quickly. They knew it was Judas. Don't you think at some point they may have raised the question, what if we had stopped Judas? What if we had intervened? I can't tell you, probably one of the hardest things to hear as a pastor is when somebody loses someone, maybe they overdose, maybe they committed suicide, maybe whatever it might be. And there's so much things that people will say, well, what if I had done this? If I had only called that day, I normally do. What if I had reached out to them? What if I hadn't? There's so much second guessing that comes in. And there's self-incrimination. Don't you think they all thought to themselves, we walked out on Jesus. In his moment of need, we worried about ourselves. We walked out on him. I don't think Peter ever got over denying him three times. You see echoes of that in 2 Peter. You see echoes of that throughout his life. He constantly thought about how it felt to walk out on his Savior. And then there's fear, real fear. They killed Jesus. We're his closest followers. Are we going to be next? Confusion. What do we do now? Grabbing at straws. You see, in just a few days, they're going to go back to fishing. Their old life. They're just going to kind of go back to what feels normal and natural. And they're not thinking at that point. They're feeling. And so when you go through these days of confusion, what tends to happen is you tend to just grab at something. Whatever will make you feel better at the moment. For some people, that's a fork. For some people, it's a bottle. For some people, it's a syringe. But grabbing at straws, for some people, it's an illicit relationship. But whatever it is, in the day of perplexity, the day of confusion, how do you get through that? Well, here's what you have to remember. In the day of confusion, you have to remember God isn't confused. When you're perplexed, you just have to remember that He isn't. Does He know every saying, yes or no? Did He see whatever you're going through coming? Yes. I was saved in 1994, and I was saved listening to the radio, and man, I wasn't looking for a preacher. I was honestly trying to find a good song. I was sitting, had a really cool car, by the way. I had a brand new red Trans Am while they still made Trans Ams, and it was awesome, black leather interior. I could go on, but I won't. It was a nice car, and I was flipping through the radio trying to find a good song to listen to, and I came across this guy talking. I thought it was the news. It was Charles Stanley. The preachers where I grew up, they were kind of loud, and they kind of shucked the corn, is what you used to call it in Alabama. They were you know, hacking preachers. They used to preach to stars. Now, you knew when you heard a preacher, you know, it was a man of God, you know. Well, Charles Stanley sounded like Dan Rather, you know. He was just talking. I thought it was the news. So I left it on there, and he started talking about Jesus. He said, God made him who knew no sin to become sin on our account, that through him we might know the righteousness of God. He said, salvation isn't about what you did at the altar. It's about what Jesus did on the cross. He put all the emphasis back on Jesus, and I thought, really? He said, it's not about turning over a new leaf and stop drinking, smoking, cussing, and chewing, and running with the people to do. He said, it's about what Jesus did. He said, so you got to look to Jesus to save you, and then He'll deal with you after that, and your life will change. I believed it. As a matter of fact, I went through drop ad in college, and I dropped all my classes, and I moved them to the evening so that in the morning I could hear all these radio preachers. It was before internet, you know, before Al Gore invented that. And so there I was, and I would listen to, you know, Focus on the Family, J. Vernon McGee, Adrian Rogers. Well, at 11:30, Chuck Swindoll came on. Chuck Swindoll was a guy, at this time, he was in Texas, and he had a program called Insight for Living, and I would park in Hardee's parking lot, and I'd order a roast beef sandwich and listen to Chuck Swindoll. I'm a creature of habit, always have been. And I would sit there, and to this day, by the way, when I hear Swindoll, I crave roast beef. But I would listen to him, and I remember a lot of things he said, but one thing that's always stuck with me, Swindoll said, Has it ever occurred to you that nothing has ever occurred to God? God has never one time looked down from heaven and gone, what are we going to do? You know, he's never thought, Michael, Gabriel, did you see what happened? I can't believe she did that. Come up with a plan, quick. Nothing, has it ever occurred to you, nothing's ever occurred to God. It's like you said, I knew you were going to do that. And when I said I loved you, I knew you were going to do it before you did it. And by the way, I have a plan. I've got a plan to love you through it. I have a plan to get you out of it. When you go through the day of confusion, remember, God's not confused. When you go through the day of perplexity, remember, he's not perplexed. You better believe in a sovereign God. You better believe in an all-knowing, all-powerful God. What comes to your mind when you think of God is the most important thing about you. When you go through that day, and some of you are there right now, you need to remember, when the disciples were going through this, you know, do you think that's why Jesus told them the week before, hey, here's what's going to happen? And he told them over and over again, I'm going to be delivered into the hands of sinners. You're going to be sorrowful, but then you're going to see me again, and everything's going to be okay. When you're in, hey, the cross was not, they didn't take his life. He gave his life. Jesus said, look, nobody takes the Son of Man's life. I lay it down. Nothing in that day had caught him off guard. The one thing they failed to do was to remember what he said. You need to be people of promise. You need to be people who know the promises of God, the plan of God, the unfolding plan of God, so that when you're in the day of confusion, you set your eyes on the promises of God and you press into, number three, the days of promise. How do I get into the days of promise? Well, Jesus said in John 16, he says, a little while you'll see me no longer, and then a little while again and you will see me. He says, you will weep and lament, you will be sorrowful, but then your sorrow is going to be turned into joy. He said, it's like a woman giving birth. She has a lot of sorrow in her pain because her hour's come. But then when she sees that baby, her sorrow is immediately turned into joy. And he said, that's going to happen for you because something amazing is going to happen. I'm going to get up from the grave. And you're going to see me alive. And for the first time ever, he was called the first fruits. He said, I'm going to be the first one ever that went into the grave and came out never to die again. Others came out, but they died again. Jesus said, I'm not going to die. I'm being resurrected forevermore to rule and to reign. And if you believe in me, the same thing will happen to you. And there will be a new heaven and a new earth. And if you can, in your confusion, in your pain, if you can be so familiar with the plan of God. God created the heavens and the earth. He made it perfect. He looked over all creation and said, behold, it is very good. Then sin came in. Adam was deceived. Eve was deceived. Satan came into the earth. They sinned. They were cast out of paradise. Then every child that was born in sin. The first two boys that were born, one murdered the other, Cain and Abel. After that, you see sin escalating upon the planet. You see the prophets saying, there's hope, there's hope. God's going to send a Messiah. Then suddenly, a star over Bethlehem. Jesus is born. God becomes flesh and dwells among us. He lives a sinless life, a perfect life. He goes to the cross, bears the weight of sin, pays for our sin, is buried. He's dead, dead, dead. And then suddenly God raises him from the dead. He ascends to the right hand of the Father and he says, go and make disciples of all nations. But he says, remember, I'm coming again. I'm coming back. And when I come back, behold, I make all things new. I'm going to make everything new. Those who are in me, I'm going to raise just like I was raised. They're going to live again and live forever. And they're going to rule and reign with me. Listen, somebody in this room might be Mayor Fernandino one day in the new heaven and new earth. Wouldn't that be awesome? You need to lay claim to it while you can, all right? Because the day's coming when everything's going to be made new. And we're not just going to go to heaven. Heaven's going to come here. New Jerusalem coming down out of heaven from the Father. And here it is, God's dwelling is with men. And behold, God is with us, Emmanuel, forever. And whatever is wrong in your life, if you put that on the left side of the scale, it is ridiculously outweighed by resurrection and new heaven and new earth. So whatever you're going through, look at the unfolding plan of God, set your hope and your heart on that and say, you say, wait, Pastor, I have cancer. And I may die within weeks. I get it. Yeah, I don't know that I do. But I can tell you this. If you're in Christ, there's no sickness that a good resurrection won't fix. Amen. Hey, you may have a brain tumor, but you're going to get a new head one day. Amen? You may have arthritis, but you're going to get new knees one day. I don't mean just these kind of doctors give you. You're going to get resurrection knees one day. You know, that's why last week so many of us, I don't know how many it was, but man, a lot of us, we get home, we eat a little bit of lunch, and then we're going to see how Tiger's doing. And we look at that screen, and man, after 11 years, he's back. I almost wore me a red polo to preach this morning. I'm telling you, man, I was pumped. He gets up there on that, he putted that little ball in, and man, he's back. And you know what? Why do we get fascinated with Tiger Woods and his big comeback? Because it gives hope to every soul that that could be me too. Man, I'm not as good as I once was, but I'm as good once as I ever was. I could come back as well. It gives us hope. The Bible says it this way. God has set eternity in the heart of man. He's woven into your DNA something that says, I'm made for forever. We see Notre Dame Cathedral burning, and 800 years that building has stood. And even though we may not have any Catholic background, or we may have grown up in a Catholic church, but we all look at that and go, man, that's not right. That shouldn't happen. That should be there forever. It's hard for us to relate with time when we're made for forever. Back in college, our music theory teacher, let's see, is that right, Gary? No, that's not right. Is that right? Close? That's it. All right. So who played that song? Is that Beethoven? Beethoven? Dun, 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 dun. However it goes, I can't play it. I failed that class. I'm being open and honest about my problems. Anyway, he would go, when class was over, he would go up to the keyboard and go, then he would walk out. And somebody would always go up there and resolve it. The gravitas of those notes pulled us back to the resolution. It pulled us back to what is the one chord? Get us back home. Don't leave us hanging. And that's what it feels like when you're going through the day of pain and perplexity. You're looking at your situation and you go, is this how it really is? Is this life? It doesn't feel like this is how it's supposed to be. And resurrection, new heaven and new earth, is what's pulling on you. And if you're going to have joy, you have to set your heart on the Easter answer. That this isn't how it's going to be. This isn't the end. There's a day when all things, Jesus said, behold, I make all things new. I set it all right. And whatever's wrong, I'll make it. I'll make things make sense in the end. He will do that in eternity, but guess what? He can do it in time as well. He can make a bad marriage a better marriage. He can forgive you. Some of you, like the disciples, when they struck the shepherd, the sheep began to flee. And some of you, you went through the day of pain, you went through the day of perplexity, and you left. You ran. I'm your pastor, and it's my job to tell you this. It's time to come home. It's time to quit running from God and start running to God. He's not perplexed. He's not surprised. He's not shocked. He's not going, I can't believe you did that. You looked at that. You went there. You put that in your body. I'm shocked. He's not doing that. He's saying, I love you. I knew you were going to do it, and I got a plan. But you got to quit running. You got to come back home. You got to keep fighting. Probably one of the great theological statements by one of the great theologians of our time, Bruce Springsteen, he talked about this reality in his song. It was a cover of Atlantic City. It was original by the band. But he said, everything dies, baby, that's a fact. But maybe everything that dies someday comes back. It's that hope of Easter. Maybe there's hope. J.R.R. Tolkien, it's very rare you'll hear a preacher quote Springsteen and Tolkien back to back, but here's the place, you know. In The Return of the King, he had a moment where Sam Ganji sees Gandalf alive again, and he says, Gandalf, I thought you were dead. Then I thought I was dead myself. Is everything sad going to become untrue? What has happened to the world? What a good word. That's it. Is it possible that everything sad is going to become untrue? Is it possible that Jesus is able to make us wake up from this nightmare called life and create a new heaven and a new earth? Well, he can. And what Christianity is tapping into that reality now. So you get through the nightmare. Focus on the promise of Easter. We quote a lot of things around our house. We quote a lot of theologians and novels and Bible, but probably one of the most frequent people that I quote the coach from Teen Wolf. You remember that guy? I quote him, and then I quote Mickey from Rocky. A lot of truth in what Mickey said. Mickey would look at Rocky, knocked down in the ring of life, and he would look like only Mickey could say it and say, I don't hear no bell. And that would give Rocky what he needed to have to get up and go one more round. And then in the next Rocky would come back and he would remember Mickey like an angel on his shoulder, and he would say to his opponent, he would say, I didn't hear no bell. And the fight would go on. Here's what you need to know in the day of pain and perplexity. It hurts, it's confusing, it's difficult, but it is not over. And God can make all things right. When life hurts, stay in the fight. When you are confused, stay in the fight. When you're broke, stay in the fight. When you're disappointed, stay in the fight. When marriage is difficult, stay in the fight. When people let you down, stay in the fight. Until you hear the bell, or in other words, the trumpet, you stay in the fight because the round's not over. You have to remember that. You have to cling to that. Jesus says, I will make all things new. Stay by the stuff. Stay with me. And don't put your hope in this world. This world is not my home. I'm just passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. The angels beckon me to heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. This world, it'll never make sense to you. You're a stranger and an alien in it. But you got to remember, our Lord is the one who says, I've overcome the world. So don't let this world get you down. Stay close to me, stay by the stuff, and remember, ultimately, you have citizenship in a city whose builder and maker is God. What a good truth on this Easter Sunday is just a little glimpse of eternity spilling over into time. And you've got to let that reality live in your heart, in your soul. Now, I want you to do me a favor. I want you to get that little card out. If you didn't get one of these, have we handed them out in this service? Have you handed them out in this service yet, Chad? If you didn't get one of these, if you'd raise your hand, we'll bring you one, all right? If you didn't get one of these, raise your hand up, and our guys will bring you one of these little cards that say spiritual survey. I want everybody to fill one of these out. Now, a couple of things they're going to ask. They're going to ask, first of all, about a topic of the Bible that you're interested in. We're going to do a series later in the year called Asking for a Friend, and we want to make sure that we're able to do what Jesus did. A lot of what Jesus taught was in response to people's questions that they raised. There's a few of them in these sections, guys. He was answering questions that people raised to him. So if you have questions about issues, mark one of those, or there where it says other, feel free to put down anything that you're curious about scripturally. What does the Bible say about this? And when we get to that series, we're going to take these into consideration and look at what you're asking as we build that series. But real importantly, down here at the bottom, it says, where are you with Jesus? Right now, where are you with Jesus? And it gives four options. Would you say you're already in a relationship? If so, mark A. If you feel like you're walking with God and things are good, mark A. If maybe you're at a place where you would like to begin a relationship and you're close, mark B. If maybe you would say, I need to consider it more. I'm a little skeptical, mark C. And that's okay, by the way. Or if you say, I don't intend to, man, I'm here because we're in the South and my wife made me. If that's you, thank you for your honesty. Just mark D. You don't have to put your name on it. This is just to help us know who we're ministering to. But if you would fill that out, we would appreciate it. And as you leave, there's little blue baskets by the door. If you'd put those in there as you go out, that would help us tremendously. Now, let me talk to the B's. Those who are ready to begin a relationship. You know, we believe you don't have to go jump through a ton of hoops to make that happen. As a matter of fact, we believe that the reason you're ready to begin that relationship is because God has already begun pursuing you and doing the work in your heart. He who begins the good work is faithful to complete it. And he's beginning it for some today. Some in our early service have already said, we're ready, we're ready. So if you're ready to begin that relationship, we want to give you an opportunity right now. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes all over the building? With heads bowed and eyes closed, as Gary comes and we prepare for the invitation, if you're in here today and you say, Pastor, I'd like to start my relationship and know that I've got a relationship with God right now. Let me invite you, if that's your heart, I want to invite you to pray this with me. Not that the prayer saves you. A person called Jesus saves you. But we confess our faith in him by calling upon his name, by praying to him. And if you know what you need to pray, you go right ahead. But if not, you might want to use these words as a guide. With heads bowed and eyes closed, as I pray out loud, why don't you pray silently and say something like this. Dear God, I know I'm a sinner. I know I need a Savior. I need to be forgiven of things. I'm willing to turn from my sin and make you the boss of my life. I believe that Jesus, the Son of God, died on a cross to save me. Maybe I don't understand it all, but I believe that what he did was enough that I could be forgiven. And I believe you raised him from the dead. Lord Jesus, would you come into my heart and change my life and give me a brand new start? Thank you for saving me. Help me to live for you and never be ashamed. Now, with heads bowed and eyes closed, some of you right then prayed that and you meant it from the bottom of your heart, and things just changed for you. According to Scripture, your sins have been forgiven and a new life just started. Without being pointed out or embarrassed, I'm not going to come get you or call you name or any of those things, but if you would just say, Pastor, I just prayed that prayer with you. I meant it from the bottom of my heart, and I believe that God answered it. If you believe God has just answered that prayer for you and you've just got saved, if that's your prayer, would you look up at me just for a moment, letting me know you prayed that and you meant it from the bottom of your heart? Just glance up and right back down. Thank you. Who else? Thank you. Who else that would just say, I prayed that. I meant it from the bottom of my heart, and I believe God answered it. Thank you. Thank you. Anybody else before we go on? Make sure if you need to raise your hand, raise it up so I see you. Make sure I see you before. Thank you. Maybe you're here today and you say, Pastor, I've been saved. I know I'm saved. but I need to unite with a tribe, a family. And maybe during this invitation, you need to step out and come and just say, we're ready to join the church. Man, we'd be so happy if you did that on Easter Sunday. I think God would be pleased if he's leading you to. In just a moment, I'm going to pray a short prayer. And if you prayed to receive Christ, then I want to encourage you. Come let us know that so we can celebrate it with you. Maybe if you're here today and you need to join, would you come and let us know and just say, I'd like to join. We would walk you through that. Whatever your decision is, there's not a better day than Easter Sunday to obey the Lord. Father, in Jesus' name, speak to hearts, change lives, give people the courage to follow through with what you're leading them to do, and we'll praise you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand to our feet. You come as God draws.
Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain.
As he plays softly, let's bow our heads and close our eyes. We're gonna sing a little bit more in a moment, but I want to give you time. If God's leading you, if he's drawing you, you come. Step out and come just like you are. It's not too late. Are you able to walk out saying, as far as I know, I've obeyed the King today? If not, you come. Gary, would you sing one for us, one more for us as we wait?
Jesus paid it all.
As our ushers make their way forward, we're going to worship through giving. As Josh said earlier, if you're a guest with us today, we don't ask you to give a dime. If you would fill that Connect card out, we would appreciate that. But that could be your gift back to First Baptist. And don't forget to drop that survey in the blue basket as you go out this morning. You know, there's something about Easter. We've had four services today, counting the beach gathering and then these three here on campus. There's a lot going on. So it's easy to forget. Historically, Easter is a difficult day for giving. So I want you to, today, if you've forgotten your check or whatever, like I almost did myself. I gave in the first service, but I almost forgot myself. If you've forgotten, don't forget on your phone, there's an option. If you go to fbfirst.com, you can click give, and you can give that way. It would help us in a season where a lot of people tend to overlook and forget. That would help us to make our budget and keep everything going the way we need to this season. All right? So give faithfully. And again, if you're our guest, just put that Connect card in the plate when it comes by you. Father, we thank you for this opportunity to give. You've been so generous to us. Help us to be generous to you. And God, help us not only to be generous, but to give joyfully. You say in your word you love a cheerful giver. Help us to give as you've given to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated.
Hi, happy Easter. I'm Sheena. We are so glad you're here today. What an honor it is to worship with you. You could have gone anywhere and you chose to be here. Now that was a powerful service. There are so many ways for you to get involved. Sunday mornings is just part of what we do. Check out a few of these ways that you and your family can get connected. Life is so much better together.
Hey guys, my name is Pastor Shad and I am the associate pastor here. And I want to tell you real fast about small groups. We have a great ministry here for people to take the next step and to get involved in small groups. Being in a congregation like ours on Sunday morning in a worship setting is fantastic. You get fed the word, but we believe here that you need to be in a smaller community to study the Bible, to get to know people, and to do life with people. And so we want to encourage you to be a part of a smaller group. On Sunday mornings, we have these groups. We have a place for you. You can just come and you can talk to me or talk to somebody at the information desk to get involved in those smaller groups. We believe that community is important, and that community is in a small group of 10 to 20 people studying God's Word, praying with each other, learning about each other, getting closer to Jesus. If you're not in a small group, I would encourage you to find me, talk to the people at the information desk about getting in a small group. You will not be disappointed.
Hey friends, my name is Christina Morse. I'm your new children's ministry director. I'm so excited to be here. Here are a couple dates in the children's ministry to look forward to. Awana Celebration is May 22nd, VBS is June 10th to June 14th, and CentraKid is July 12th to July 14th. I'm so excited to meet y'all. If you see me in the hallways, come up and introduce yourself and give me a high five.
What's up, guys? Josh here with Motion Students. We're the Ministry of First Baptist for 6th grade through 12th grade students, and I want to invite you to come check us out this Wednesday night at 6 o'clock. We're doing a color war in the backyard. That's in the back of the church. It's going to be an awesome time. The first 100 students get a free t-shirt, and we want you to be there. We got stuff going on all year long, so check us out, and I can't wait to see you there.